Greetings again today in that name that's far above every name, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. May the good Lord bless you. We welcome every one of you. You that's listening out in the radio listen audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. You'll call a friend, have them to tune in, get the hour coming up. I do feel we can be an inspiration to them. And the tape today will be tape number 308. Tape number 308. I'm speaking today on the subject, something everybody has and nobody wants. Tape number 308, something everybody has and nobody wants. Take your Bible and turn to the book of Job chapter 5. You'll find that on page 572 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. I have about a half a dozen or more Scofield Reference Bibles, the original, and I can save you a little on them. If you're thinking about one for Christmas, get in touch with me. Be glad to talk with you about it. I can save you around $10 to $15 on the Bible. I've accumulated them over the year when I could get them at maybe a discount. And so I do have a few on hand, especially if our members here or you in the radio listen audience. I'd like to hear from you. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. I am in need. I'm in need of hearing from the listener. This is a faith ministry, and we work this together in getting out the gospel. God gave the word. Great is the company of those that publish it. I can't do it alone. I must have your prayers, your financial support, your concern, in order to keep this ministry going out over there. It's not a fly-by-night ministry. I'm now in my 40th year of daily broadcasting from the classic city of Athens, Georgia. I appreciate hearing from you. I appreciate your letters, your cards and whatnot, even your beautiful Christmas cards that come in around this time of the year. My wife and I cherish them very highly. We place them in our living room, decorate our living room each Christmas with our Christmas cards. They're very beautiful. We cherish them and look at them during the Christmas season. And we appreciate Christmas cards from our friends that lets us know we have friends that listen to us, appreciate our ministry. So you pray for me and write to me this coming week. Now that Bible open at Job chapter 5, page 572, I begin reading with verse 1. Call now if there be any that will answer thee, and to which of the saints will thou turn? For wrath killeth the foolish man, and envy slayeth the silly one. I've seen the foolish taking root, but suddenly I cursed his habitation. His children are far from safety, and they're crushed in the gate. Neither is there any to deliver them. Whose harvest the hungry eateth up, and taketh even out of the thorns, and the robbers swallow up their substance. Although affliction cometh not forth of the dust, neither does trouble spring out of the ground. Yet man is born under trouble as the sparks fly upward. Notice that verse, would you please? Verse 7. Yet man is born under trouble as the sparks fly upward. Now turn again, will you please, to chapter 14 of the book of Job. It's page 578. I want to read one verse. Man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. You get that? Let me give it to you again. Man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. Speaking on the subject, something everybody has and nobody wants, and that is trouble. In almost every family today, you find some kind of problem or some kind of trouble. There were two little boys playing on a train. The conductor said, these two boys must behave or there will be trouble. The boy's father said, "You don't know what trouble is. My wife's in the hospital. I'm on my way to see my sick mother-in-law. My daughter had just had triplets. One of these boys just mashed his finger, and the other one just chewed up our tickets. And to top it all off, we just discovered we're on the wrong train." So you can always find people that have trouble, worse shape than you are. I turned on the TV the other night. It had some kind of worldly musical program on, but what caught my eye, there was a man, had no arms and hands, of course, and he was playing a string instrument with his feet. He was singing and playing with his feet, and he was doing a good job. Now, you can always find somebody in worse shape than you are. We all have trouble, every one of us of some kind. Some have more trouble seemingly than others at various times. And that's something everybody has and nobody wants. And I've never seen a time when there's much trouble and much heartaches and disappointments and problems in homes as you find in this day in which we live. Just about every home has some kind of difficulty, some kind of problem. Man called me twice this past week, said, "Preacher, I'm an alcoholic. Could you please help me? I don't know what to do. Would you please tell me what to do?" I said, "Yes, quit drinking." "Well, he can't do that." "Well," I said, "that's the only way you stop it. Just don't drink anymore. If you want to get out of that problem, quit your drinking. And then that'll solve your problem." And everybody has some kind of problem or heartache. We live in perilous times, momentous days, wicked days, and the world situation as far as sin is concerned is getting worse all the time. Because you have more people being born, sin multiplying, and is filling the land. And there's many problems now. Now, I'm not a pessimist, I'm a truthist. There'll be many more to come, more than there are now. And you might as well get ready for it. Now I'm going to use the man Job here as an example of a man that had trouble. Now Job was a godly man. He was a good man. That was the man living on the face of the earth that lived in it closer to God and walked in it closer with God than the man Job. The devil admitted that. The devil had to admit there's none on the earth like him. Job was an old patriarch, and the book of Job is probably the oldest book in the Bible. Somebody said it might have been Job who was living in the days of building the pyramids in Egypt. That may be true. But anyway, Job had problems, although he was a godly man. He was a man that lived real close to God. Now, many people today that are godly, fully consecrated, filled with God's Spirit, and yet they still have problems. Now, just because you're walking with the Lord doesn't mean that you're not going to have trouble or problems. You will, you may have. Now, we do know if you're not living right, that's going to add to your problems. You're going to have more problems. But you may be living as close to God, as consecrated as any human being that you know about, and still you're going to run into difficulties. You'll have problems as you move down a life's highway. You must remember that. Now, this man Job lived for God, walked with God. When his children went out to a birthday party, he would slip along, offer a sacrifice unto God just in case they did something they should not have done. How many of you today, when your children are out at night, when your young people are out traveling around at night, and you don't know where they are, how many of you ever get out on your knees and pray for them while they're out there in sin? I've known godly mothers that would not sleep one wink, not close their eyes and sleep, until they heard the footsteps of the last child coming in on Saturday night. They would pray on their knees, lie there in the bed and pray till those children came in. When that last child came in, they'd go to sleep. How many of you lose sleep today because of wayward children or children out in the world? They're facing an evil world out here, and you need to realize that, and you need to follow them with your prayers. That man Job did exactly that, but he lost everything he had. Now we lose some things. We lose our health many times. We lose our wealth. We lose our friends. This man Job had trouble on top of trouble. He lost everything that he had. He lost his sheep. He had many sheep. He was a wealthy man, a very rich man in his day. He lost his oxen. He had many oxen. He lost his camels. He had many camels. He lost his asses. He had many of them. And he lost his servants. And he lost his children. This man, Job, lost everything. Then he lost his health and so forth. He had trouble. Every way he turned, he had trouble. Now, you must remember there's trouble out there facing you. And if you're not having it now, you will have it sooner or later. You might as well get set for it. We're living in an evil world. Now they have a bill coming up now to be voted on in the state of Georgia that if any man, if they can say he's mentally retarded, if he, I don't care how many people he kills and plans and schemes and kills and robs and rape and cold-blooded murder, if they can say that boy is, a man is mentally retarded, then he gets away from the lecture chair. That means he serves a little time and turned loose again out there among society, out in the world. Now the liberals and infidels are all doing that because they love crime, they hate righteousness, and they're for evil. And many of these crooked lawyers, whenever that man is sitting there and they're trying that man and getting ready to try him, then many crooked lawyers have put some mentally retarded people in the jury box and they'll take care of the old. They'll say, well, the man is mentally retarded. Now you listen to this Baptist preacher, whether you like it or not. If a man has sense enough to plan a robbery, plan a rape, plan to kill somebody, I don't care, you can call him mentally retarded. You can say he has a very low IQ. You can say he's black, white, red, or yellow. You can say what you please. That man deserves a front seat in the electric chair. That's right. And let God be true and every man a lie. I don't care what these liberals say about it. And these some of these crooked lawyers and some of these crooked judges. I don't care what they say about it. Some of these liberals today that's trying to do away with capital punishment. They are dead wrong. They're opposing God, the word of God, and common sense. And they are against the law-abiding citizens in the United States of America, whether you like it or not. If you don't like it, you leave it, lump it, leap it, or whatever you want to do. It's the truth anyhow. And because of many of these things, you're going to face more trouble as you move down the road today. Job lost everything he had. He was a righteous man. Secondly, he had the devil to contend with. Now, a lot of people, they like to joke about the devil. Now, they can joke about him, say what they please about him. He's a reality. He is a person. The Bible says in Job chapter 1, verses 6, 8, and 9, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. The Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for naught? Now who is God talking to here? He's not talking to the president of the country. He's not talking to the governor. He's not talking to some farmer out there. The Bible said he was talking to the devil. Now there is a devil, whether you like it or not. Now you better believe it. There is a devil. Now you people that saved, you know that. You people that are not saved, I don't guess you could care less because it never bothers you. But there is a devil, and he's going to keep you from getting saved. And when you get saved, he's going to set you down and keep you from serving God and do everything he can to harm and hurt you and trouble you to keep you from being your best to God. But there is a devil. Number three, we find that Job had some friends. They lived in his community. They heard about the old man losing everything he had and losing his health. And so they decided they would pay him a visit. And these three friends came and paid him a visit. And the Bible says in Job chapter 2 and verse 11, now when Job's friends heard of all this evil that was upon him, everyone from his own place came and to see what it was all about. And they saw him in such condition until they couldn't even speak to him. They sat there about a week and just looked at him and gazed at him. And they claimed to be his friends. But you know, he lost those friends. They turned against him. While they said, Job, if you were living right, you wouldn't have lost all your wealth. Job, if you were living right, you wouldn't have lost your health. Now, Job, if you'd have been living right, your wife wouldn't have turned against you. Job, if you'd have been living right, you wouldn't have had to follow 10 children to the cemetery and bury them. You would have lost everything you had, Job, and your health and all, everything. You lost it all. If you're a hypocrite, Job, why, Job, you're not living right. And they sat there and judged that man, and he had trouble on top of trouble, and he was the greatest God-fearing man in the East. He was a man that loved God with all of his heart. But I don't know any man that had any more trouble than Job. Now we bury a loved one, and it breaks our heart. Sometimes we bury two, sometimes three. But this man, Job, followed 10 children to the graveyard and placed them in the ground. There's a man lost every child he had. He had 10 of them. They were grown children, and he lost every one of them, buried 10 children. And then he was a healthy man and a wise man and a man with wisdom, and he lost his health. Well, he got in the place where he had to lay down in ashes, and he had boils all over his body, and he couldn't rest not 1 minute without pain shooting through his body. He lost his health. He was miserable day and night. His wife saw him suffering until she went to him and said, Job, well, why don't you just start cussing and let God kill you? Why don't you curse God and die? And of course, we criticize her for saying that. But you know, sometimes you got to realize this, that whenever there's a companion that's ill and a lot of problems and suffering, it begins to work on their companion. And it gets them sometimes all upset and gets them irritable and gets them kind of in foul shape because it's bearing on them and hurting them about as bad as hurting the sick person. And we shouldn't be critical at our loved ones sometimes when they get kind of upset at us. I remember my dad lay flat on his back almost for a year. My mother sat up day and night. She tried to rest at night, and she'd go to bed. And by the time she'd get in the bed, he'd call her. And we children would sit up with him and try to help him. We'd say, Daddy, let Mama rest. And she needs some rest. And oh, I want my wife. And well, I said, I can do what she wants of it. No, I want my wife. And he'd call her. And maybe she'd been in the bed 15 minutes, hadn't slept any all day and night, maybe gone days and night. She'd get out of the bed and see what my daddy wanted. And she was very patient. I've never seen anybody any more patient than my mother. But we children wasn't that patient. I'll be honest with you. I got upset with him several times. And the other children did, the boys especially. They didn't have much patience. Now, my oldest sister, she had patience like my mother. She never spoke a cross word to my dad during his year of illness while he was flat on his back, as far as I know. But we boys couldn't quite take it that good. I'd say, Dad, what's wrong with you? I can do what Mama can do. Let her rest. No, I want my wife. I want my wife. And she'd crawl out of the bed and wait on him. And I got impatient. Now, many times when you have sickness, and men can't take sickness like women can, as a general rule, and the wife waits on the husband day and night, and she's bound to feel the effects, and she suffers with him, and she might get a little bit irritable. You better understand that. I'll tell you, it takes almost a perfect person with perfect strength from God not to get a little irritable sometimes trying to wait on us men, because we can't take sickness many times like a woman. They can get sick and seem like cope with it better than the men. And Job's wife, she was so irritable and so angry at Job. And she said, Job, you just need to go ahead and backslide on God and curse God and die and get out of your misery. You're in a terrible shape, Job. What did Job say to his wife? Job said to his wife, he said, you talk like a foolish woman to me. I'm not going to curse God. If God kills me, I'll serve him. I'm not going to curse God. I'm not going to backslide on God. Oh, she said, Job, you need to just go ahead and start cussing out loud. Just go ahead and curse God. Just go ahead and let God kill you. Get out of your misery. He said, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. He said, I'm going to serve God if God kills me. In Job chapter 2 and verse 9, then said his wife unto him, does I still retain thy integrity? Curse God and die. Job, you mean to tell me, my dear husband, you're going to still try to serve God in the shape you're in? You've lost everything. You've lost your health, lost your friends. We buried our children. Are you still going to serve God? He said, yes, I'm going to serve God. I don't care what happens to me. Number four, you'll find he will have trouble. The backslider will have trouble. And this adds to his trouble. Now, a good man can have trouble. And he's going to face some troubles and difficulties and problems sometimes he doesn't know how to solve. He'll have them, but it must look to God to help him. But that backslider has additional troubles. In Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 6, Hebrews rather 2 and verse 6, for whom the Lord chastens, he scourges every son he receives. That's chapter 12, verse 6 of Hebrews. The Bible said there that if you're a born again believer, you know you've been washed in the precious blood of the Lamb. You've been saved by the grace of God. You go out here and backslide on God and go your own merry way and ignore God and ignore God in His house, ignore God in His service, and ignore God's work financially when you know that a portion of your income belongs to God, and you go ahead. If you'd rather go out and pay it to some other means and give it to God, that's a matter between you and God. But many backsliders bring trouble on themselves because they're backsliding. Now, I'm not talking about Christians walking with God. I'm talking about backsliders. If you're not a backslider, I'm not talking about you. If you're living for God, serving God the best you know, I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about that backslider that knows what he ought to do and don't do it. A lot of people are so hard-headed, you could tell them, now, you ought to tithe your income, and they say, well, I'm just not able to. Well, go ahead and give it to the doctor. Go ahead and give it to the mechanic. Go ahead and give it to the dentist. Go ahead and give it to somebody else, and then you're going to be a loser when you face God. Oh, beloved, if we'd get wise and wake up and realize that God can help us when we need, and if you'll take care of God's business, then God will help you take care of your business. You go ahead like a goat, hard-headed, and ignore God, ignore what you're supposed to do, and one of these days you're going to need God to help you, and you're not going to be able to find Him. You didn't come to God's rescue when God wanted you to help Him, and God just lets you get by the best way you can, and you're most certainly going to come out in the hole. God Almighty chastened Israel when Israel backslid on God. Seven times God brought them back. He used evil nations to chastise them. God chastised David 4:4 when David committed his sin. God chastised Jonah, ended up in the belly of a whale when he became disobedient. God chastised Simon Peter when he started cussing when he ought to have been praising God. And you find example in the prodigal son, how he went down to the hog pen and lived with the hogs when he could have been back home. Now that backslider is going to have additional trouble. He's going to have a backslider's problem. Now if you're a born again believer, you're going to have a Christian's trouble and problems, but God will help you. That backslider is inviting more trouble and more problems and going to get himself into a terrible predicament if he continues on down that road. And then the sinner has problems. The sinner has trouble. In Proverbs chapter 13, verse 15, the way of the transgressor is hard. Now that sinner's out here trying to find satisfaction. He's out here in a wicked, ungodly world. And he's on dope, or he's on liquor, or he can't hold a job, or his home's broken up. The devil's wrecked his family. And man, he has problems. The Bible said he's like the troubled sea. He's forever casting up dirt and mire. And the more problems it has, the worse it gets, the more dirt and mire is going to cast up. And beloved, it's going to get awful foggy down the road for that poor sinner. And then in addition, there you die and go to hell. Isn't that awful? A poor lost sinner has a hard road. Man said the other day to me, called me, he said, preacher, I'm an alcoholic. I'm thinking about committing suicide. I said, man, what are you talking about? You going to jump out of the frying pan into the fire? Is that going to help you? Jumping out of the frying pan into the fire? He said, no, I don't guess it will. I said, no, that's not the answer. Committing suicide is not the answer. That's jumping out of the frying pan into the fire. Now, nobody should be thinking about that. That's wrong thing. That's not the way out, but a lot of people are thinking about it, and a lot of people do it. Young people commit suicide. That's terrible. And it's getting worse all the time. That sinner is in deep trouble. And he's going to face more and more trouble as he sojourns. I'm speaking to you about something everybody has and nobody wants. I don't know anybody who really wants trouble, but they're having it. Now, Job knew his testing was for a purpose. Job said in Job chapter 1, verse 22, in all this Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. Now, I want that verse of scripture to sink in. Now, you listen to this Baptist preacher. Job, in all this sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. Sometimes when you have these problems, you're tempted to say, well, I don't deserve this. Why is God letting this happen to me? Don't you charge God foolishly. God knows what he's doing. You got to be patient like Job. Job knew that in the end time, God's going to work it out. And he said in Job chapter 13, verse 15, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Job said, if God kills me, I'm going to serve him anyhow. In Job chapter 23 and verse 10, but he that knoweth the way that I take, when he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Now you listen to me. There'll be questions in your mind as to why it happened to you, why you have problems when somebody else don't, why this difficulty has come your way. But if you remain true to God, stay true to God, serve God, like Job of old, one of these days you can come out like pure gold. That's what Job did. He came out like pure gold. After all, gold is tried in the fire. To purify gold, you try it in the fire, and it shines brighter. It purifies in the fire. So when you go through trouble and you're tried and you're tempted and you're tested, one of these days when you come out like gold, you'll look back and praise God. You'll say, God, I'm sorry I didn't understand it. I'm sorry, Lord, I misjudged the situation. I'm sorry, Lord, I wondered why it happened to me, and now I'm come out as pure gold. That's exactly what Job did. Job knew his way out. Now, it's a great day in the morning when you know your way out. I'm going to tell you the way out in just a moment. Job knew his way out. Everybody has problems. We have something, everybody has something nobody wants, and that's trouble. In Job chapter 19, verses 25 and 26, Job said, I know my Redeemer liveth. You know Jesus liveth today? Do you know your Redeemer's alive today? Do you? Job said, I know my Redeemer liveth, and he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. Job said, Jesus is coming to the earth one of these days. He knew that back in his day. And then he said, and though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God. Now, what did Job say? Job said, oh, I'm in sad shape. I'm miserable. I got this wretched disease, boils all over my body. And he said, one of these days, although the worm's going to eat this old body, but said, I'm going to see my Savior, and I'm going to stand in the last days in a brand new body and see the Lord. A lot of people never have a minute without suffering. A lot of people can't sleep at night because of suffering. A lot of people go all day long suffering, some kind of problem. Did it ever occur to you that's coming a day when you're going to get a new body, a brand new body, like unto the Lord's? There'll never be one pain to come to that body. Not one minute suffering, no heartache. It'll never grow any older. It'll always be a young body, a body of youth. Do you ever think about that? It's going to happen. And then we find that there was a time came when God let the sun shine in Job's back door again. It may be cloudy around your house. Rain may come, thunderheads may come, a storm may come. It may get real cloudy and windy, but there's a day coming when the sun's going to break through those clouds and shine in your back door again. Just be patient. Just be patient. Trouble is something everybody has, nobody wants. Be patient, serve God, have the patience of Job. And when God moves the clouds back and the sun shines through, you can praise God, the sun shining again in your back door. In Job chapter 42 and verse 6, wherefore I hold myself and a pen in dust and ashes. Now Job had a little pride about him, and he found that out, and he got rid of that pride. And then you know what he did? He prayed those friends of his that came and criticized him. Oh, he said, my Three neighbors came over here and criticized me and called me a hypocrite. Said I was a hypocrite, wasn't living right. That's why I was suffering like I suffered. He said, God have mercy on them. God forgive them. God help those neighbors of mine. They didn't know what they was talking about. And he prayed for them. And we find in chapter 42, verses 10 through 13, and the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also the Lord gave Job twice his mercy he had before. Then there came unto him all of his brethren, and all of his sisters, and all they that had been of the acquaintance before, and did eat bread with him in his house, and they bemoaned him and comforted him over all the evil that the Lord had brought upon him. Every man also gave him a piece of money, every one an earring of gold, and the Lord blessed the latter end of Job more than his beginning, for he had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, 1,000 she asses. He also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. And verse 15, in all the land were no women found so fair as the daughters of Job. And verses 16 through 17, after this lived Job 140 years, and saw his sons and his sons' sons, even 4 generations. So Job died, being old and full of years. Job had trouble. Trouble is something that we all have and nobody wants. That's the message. Job, in the end, had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and his daughters, the most beautiful women on the earth. That he lost the first 10 he had, and God gave him 10 more. And they were handsome men and beautiful daughters. And everybody brought him some money and so forth. He had more in the end time than he had in the beginning. He lost everything, but he had twice as much in the end than he had in the beginning. And when the old man died, 10 fine children, handsome boys, beautiful daughters followed that old casket out to the graveyard. And they said, thank God for Daddy. He had a rough time years ago, but he knew all of that was for a trial. He knew he was going to come out all right. He had great faith in God. He suffered all right. Even Mama tried to get him to commit suicide, but he wouldn't. And he stood true to God. And we're going to bury old Daddy, the greatest man that ever lived. Thank God for Daddy. And those 10 young'uns buried old man Job. He saw his great, 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 great grandchildren. They all came around when they buried the old man. Feel as covered up as it put the old man in the grave. Job stood true to God. This I close. Job's problems was for a testing. The devil had an argument with God. The devil said, if you put him through this, he'll backslide, he'll curse you. God said, we'll see what he'll do. And God let the devil test Job to see what he would do. And Job stood true. Whatever your trouble is, or your problem is, it may be for testing. You just stand true to God, regardless what people say or think. You stand true to God, because there could be greater things for you on down the road. Let's stand up, feet. Father, I pray today that you use the message to thy name's honor and glory. God, may Jesus be glorified. Father, no doubt right now there's hundreds, maybe thousands, that heard this message today, that's going through troublesome times. Lord, we all have something we don't want, and that's trouble. The ones that don't have it will have it eventually. God, help us. Help us to look to thee for grace and strength as we sojourn in Christ's name. Amen. Debbie's going to play for us on the instrument. Now listen to me. If you're here today and you're unsaved, you want to get saved, you come down here, we'll help you to God. If you're backslidden on the Lord, you want to come back into fellowship, you come on down here, we'll help you back into fellowship. If you're here and you want to join this church the way we receive members, you come down, we'll take that in consideration. If there's any other reason that you feel you need to come down here, let us help you. I want you to come while we wait, while she plays softly. Would you come? How about it? Thank you. about it while we wait. You and you alone know whether God has spoken to your heart.